Well, good morning, Heartland. It's such an honor to be here. And before I get started, I live in Phoenix, and it's a little cold here. Let's just get that out of the way. And I just feel like there's places to serve that are really, really worthy of honor. Okay, I think every person who serves in a volunteer capacity in the local church, they deserve to be honored for what they do. If you serve in junior high ministry, you deserve to be honored again and again. If you serve in the parking lot in the winter and you wear orange, I just feel like you deserve to be honored. And I know you're not even in here probably, but can we just thank them just one more time? If you're parking lot teams, thank you for what you do. Well, this past week I was in Tampa and I was speaking at this business gathering and got on the plane and flew from Tampa to Chicago, but it was really bad weather Friday night. And so they only had one runway open at O'Hare. And so they put us in a holding pattern above O'Hare, and we were up there for about 2 hours. And as we're just kind of waiting, and I'm literally like, where do we go in a holding pattern? Like, are we just going in circles? What are we doing? And finally, the pilot got on and said, hey, they haven't cleared us for landing, but we're running out of fuel. So we're going to go to Indianapolis. When, number one, you never want to hear a captain say you're running out of fuel. So then we went to Indianapolis, and we sat there on the plane for a couple of hours, and they couldn't find the fuel, I think, and then they found it, and then they had to like de-ice the plane, and then finally we were able to land at like 1 a.m. yesterday morning, and I realized, like, man, this is some crazy weather. This is some crazy weather, but I am so grateful to be here. But while I was in a holding pattern, I already had a message prepared. And I had already sent all my slides into the amazing, like, communications and tech team. They were all ready to go. And then I landed, and I just fired off a text, and I said, I think I'm supposed to give a different message. I know you don't really know me very well, so can we just make a little bit of a switch? And the team was like, yeah, let's do it. Let's do it. And so this is a message that I just feel like is important for today. You don't know me very well. We're still kind of getting to know each other, but I'll tell you, this whole series that Eric, myself, and the team have kind of dreamed up is, man, how do we come to the table and really talk about things in a real Jesus way, in a real God-honoring way, in a real Bible-centered way? And that's my hope. That's my heart. And at times I might push a little bit, but I hope that you understand my whole desire with preaching is to make disciples who make disciples who make disciples. And so if at any moment you feel uncomfortable, that's good. Welcome to church. If there's moments where you think I'm trying to say something that I don't say, I'm not. I will say what I want to say. And what I want to say and help is you to understand the way of Jesus. That is my heart. So let me take you back, because you're all like, what's he going to say? Let me take you back to growing up. I grew up in Southern California. My dad collected records. One of my favorite things was to go into his office. I would open up the closet, and inside his closet, he'd have these milk crates, and they were filled with amazing albums. Abbey Road, The Beatles, Led Zeppelin 1, 2, and 3, you know, Earth, Wind, and Fire. I mean, and he would tell the story. He would tell the story of when he purchased this album, why he bought this album. He'd tell me stories about Brian Wilson, how he went crazy after he put out one of the best albums ever, but then The Beatles dropped Sgt. Pepper's, and he couldn't take it. He would tell me these stories. And my dad passed away last year. Really heartbreaking. But a few months before he passed, I drove up to Grand Rapids, Michigan. I walked down to the basement and I said, Dad, let's look at records. And so we went down and he had a few records. I said, is there any story you haven't told me? And he picked up this album by Stevie Wonder. And he said, have I ever told you this story? I said, no. And this album came out in 1981. Maybe you had it, maybe you listened to it. It was called Hotter Than July. This is what it looked like. But in this album, there was a song called Happy Birthday. And in 1981, Stevie Wonder, when you opened up this album, in the sleeve of this album was a picture of Dr. Martin Luther King. And you might see this picture, and you see words that are underneath, and I want to read these words over you because I think they're so beautiful. This is what Stevie Wonder said. It is believed for a man to lay down his life for the love of others is the supreme sacrifice. Jesus Christ, by his own example, showed us that there is no greater love. Stevie Wonder dropping the gospel. Well done. For nearly 2,000 years now, we have been striving to have the strength to follow that example. Martin Luther King was a man who had that strength. He showed us, nonviolently, a better way of life, a way of mutual respect, helping us to avoid much bitter confrontation and inevitable bloodshed. We still have a long road to travel until we reach the world that was his dream. We in the United States must not forget either his supreme sacrifice or that dream. I and a growing number of people believe that it is time for our country to adopt legislation that will make January 15th, Martin Luther King's birthday, a national holiday, both in recognition of what he achieved and as a reminder of the distance which still has to be traveled. Join me in the observance of January 15th, 1981, as a national holiday. Stevelyn Morris, a.k.a. Stevie Wonder. It wasn't until 1983 that legislation was passed, and it wasn't until 1986 that it was declared a national holiday, Martin Luther King. And it wasn't until the year 2000 when every one of the 50 states of the Union decided to follow along. And the first decade of the 2000s, known as the aughts, which is a bizarre name, but it wasn't until the very end of the aughts, 2009, 2010, when institutions, businesses, churches actually began to recognize this day and set it apart. And maybe Stevie's right. We still have a long way to travel. This message is called Deep Fears. And I often wonder what prevents us, what stops us, what inhibits us from actually getting to know our neighbor, people who are different from us, people who have different backgrounds, are different ethnicities, different roles. What prevents us? And yes, it would be really, really, really easy to say it's fear, but I think it's more than that. I think it's deeper than that. And today, what I want to do is just in a few moments, I want to unpack a word and then take you to some of the last words of Jesus and begin to expound on how we can come to the table and sit with every tongue, tribe, and nation for Christ's glory. Let's go to the word. And for me, it's this word, bias. And bias can be defined in two ways. Attitudes and stereotypes that affect how we understand our actions and decisions in an intentional manner. That would be explicit bias. That literally, this is where racism, where prejudice happens in an explicit way. It's where someone goes, you know what, I'm just not going to hang out with those people. I am not going to engage with those people. I am not going to love those people, even though the Bible tells me to. But there's another kind of bias that I believe is just as dangerous, and it's called implicit bias. And implicit bias is defined as attitudes and stereotypes that affect how we understand our actions and decisions in an unconscious manner, in a subconscious way. It's the decisions that we don't even know that we are making. It's the things and decisions of how we understand the world in a way that we sometimes are even unaware of. For instance, eBay did a study, and they discovered that iPads and iPods and iPhones sell at a significantly higher rate if they are being held with white hands instead of hands from people of color. Explicit bias? Maybe. Implicit bias? 100%. And you can talk about this in most arenas, from sports, from medical, from professors in universities. And I experienced this because a couple of weeks after the Los Angeles Holocaust Museum opened, a buddy of mine got in the car. We were living in Orange County, going to school, and we drove down. We showed up, got our tickets. There's about 50, 60 of us in the kind of waiting area when this female gets up, and she's the tour guide, and she's strong and great, great thinker. And she said, "Hey, before we go any farther, there's two doors. Door number one, door number two. And here's my question to you. If any of you have any sense of prejudice, racism, or stereotype bias within you, feel free to walk through door number one. And if any of you don't have any racism, prejudice, stereotype, or bias within you, feel free to walk through door number two." And I kid you not, when she pointed to door number two, the majority of us just began to walk that way. Because nobody just wants to say that I got something broken within me. And as I'm walking towards door number two, my buddy grabs me. And he goes, hey, Steve, just think about this. Any prejudice, any stereotype, any just racism, any bias? I mean, that's a big word, any. It's like, I don't know if I can walk through door number two. And we're having like this existential conversation in the lobby. And so we look at each other and like, okay, let's go through door number one. And I have no idea where door number one's gonna take us. I feel like it's gonna lead us to like some back alley where we're gonna get jumped or something. And we walk through door number one, and when we walk through door number one, you know where we walk into? A large room where we see the other people. And the woman gets back up and she goes, "My friends, I want you to know that every one of us has some broken pieces, some bias within us. And if we do not begin to uncover the subconscious and the implicit bias that we hold, we might just find ourselves a part of another Holocaust." And literally as a 20-year-old, my mind was blown. And I sat there and just began to go, man, how would Jesus want us to live? How, if we all came to the table and Jesus just kind of said, hey, can I just remind you of some things that I said, how I want my Talmudim, my disciples to live today, I wonder what he'd say. As I started to process that, I just remembered some of the last words he said. If you have a Bible, turn with me to Acts chapter 1, verse 8. And it says this, Jesus speaking to his disciples. And he says, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." I love this. This is what Jesus is saying. Hey, you need to understand something. That when the Spirit comes, the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity, you know what? This Spirit's going to come, and it's going to come with power. And this word power in Greek is where we get the word dynamite. There is going to be a dynamic move within you. And you know what? You're actually going to be my witnesses to what I'm doing in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And so, when you study the scriptures, you have to ask yourself, how would a first century Talmudim, a first century disciple, understand this? Well, these four environments symbolize something to them. See, for instance, Jerusalem was their familiar. And we all have a familiar. My familiar is Camarillo. California, a city between Malibu and Santa Barbara near the coast. 63,000 people, very low diversity, a whole bunch of soccer moms and minivans. We love our sports. That's what I knew. That is my familiar. You have your familiar. Maybe you grew up here in Rockford. Maybe you grew up in St. Louis. God forbid, Cardinal fan. But like maybe that was your familiar, right? And the tendency is to live within your familiar, to stay put in what you've ever only known. But here's the thing. You know what? I believe Jesus is trying to get to these disciples is to give them a bias cleanse. A bias cleanse. You know what a bias cleanse is? It's when you see people like God sees people. And what Jesus says is when the Spirit comes upon us in power, we're not just going to bear witness in our familiar position and our familiar places, but he's literally going to step and invite us to take a step outside our comfort zones. And the first place we'll go is to Judea. Now, what's Judea? Judea is not Jerusalem. Jerusalem had the temple. Jerusalem had the money. Jerusalem had the best schools. Judea, it's like the country. Judea is like the cornfields. Judea are the people that we see as less than. You have any of those people in your life? What's amazing is I fly a lot right now. And one of the things that I do is get very, very curious about how people treat TSA employees. Very rarely does someone look a TSA agent in the eye and say, thank you for what you're doing. You know what they usually do? You want me to take off my belt? Like, it's super passive aggressive. You want me to dump out all my water? Like, you want me to take out my iPad? And the TSA agent's like, I'm trying to protect you. But people literally view TSA agents as less than. It's unfortunate. And truth be told, there's probably people in our lives that we view as less than. We view them by the labels that they wear, their fashion sense, their title, their position, or their lack of title or lack of position, the kind of car they drive, or the fact that they don't drive a car. Their zip code, their bank account, their past. Little by little, find ourselves viewing people as a little inferior to us. And what's so amazing is Jesus goes, no, you don't understand. See, when the Spirit of God comes, he's going to come with power. And you are actually going to bear witness. And you're going to have a bias cleanse. And you are going to see all of the Judeans like my Father sees them. You're actually not going to see them as less than. You're going to see them as he sees them. And then Jesus ain't done. He's not just taking you to Judea. He's taking you to Samaria. And where's Samaria? Samaria is the people you can't stand. Judea is the people you view as less than. Samaria is the people you just can't stand. But why? See, Samaritans back in those days were half Jewish, half Gentile. And the Hebrew people hated them. A rabbi would say, you know what's terrible? It's terrible to be born a Samaritan. This was like in the teachings of rabbis. There was a literal hatred towards rabbis. But you know what? These rabbis were unlike Jesus. Because Jesus in John chapter 4 says that he had to go to Samaria. And the first person that he entrusts with the story of who he is in the Gospel of John is a Samaritan woman. And this Samaritan woman becomes the first evangelist in the book of John. And what's so incredible is we have people in our life that we can't stand. See, Samaritans are similar to us, yet different. You know, whenever a producer is pitching a movie in Hollywood, one of the easiest ways for them to get a movie sold is that they will say, it's similar to Top Gun, but different because it's working with the Coast Guard. And then we're going to have Kevin Costner and Ashton Kutcher. Same storyline, just no planes, just some boats. And this is literally how they will pitch movies. But here's the thing. For the Jews and the Samaritans, they were similar because Samaritans were part Jewish, but they were different. And I think the Samaritans in our life are often, they're American, yet they're Democrats. They're American, yet they're Republicans. They're American, just like me, yet they're an atheist. They're American, just like me, but they're LGBTQ+. They're American, just like me, but there's some area of difference. And literally what often happens is people rise up and they view them as Samaritans. And I believe what Jesus is saying is the Spirit's going to come and he's going to give you a bias cleanse. And you're going to see the people that you view as less than the Judeans as God sees them. And you're going to see the Samaritans, the people you can't stand in your own life, just like how God sees them. But it doesn't just stop there. Jesus says the Spirit of God is going to take you from the familiar to Judea, to Samaria, and then to the ends of the earth. But what does that represent? The ends of the earth symbolizes the people that we have no desire to understand. See, if you were a Jewish boy, you didn't go to the ends of the earth. You stayed in your Jerusalem. Part of the reason sometimes the disciples were so scared because Jesus was taking them across the lake to Gentile country. And this is what Jesus is saying, is literally, when you begin to bear witness to the Spirit's power and to Jesus at work in you, he's literally going to take you to places that you have no desire to understand. Places in your story where maybe you've just wanted to turn the news off. Places in your life where you're like, I don't even want to talk about that. Places in your life where like, I want to turn a blind eye. It's like willful blindness to that issue. And here's the truth. Some of our fear has created apathy. And literally, little math problem for you, apathy plus fear creates equals a phobia. Just sit for a second and ask yourself, how do you feel when words like Iran, immigration, refugee, Muslim? Now, I can go on for a whole list. And what often happens is there is something inside of us that goes, I don't want to engage with that. And what's so incredible is Jesus saying, you know, when the Spirit comes upon you in power, you're going to want to actually leave your familiar comfort zone where you're literally in control. And you're going to go on this journey and adventure to the people that you think are less than, to the people that you can't stand, and the people you have no desire to understand. But here's the truth. I start thinking about this, and I realize something. This is not the whole story. I mean, you look at it on a linear map and you begin to see the movement of God, what Jesus is trying to get his people. But then if you are familiar with the scriptures and you begin to flip to the very end of the Bible, you begin to realize in Revelations 21 and 22, you begin to discover that there is a whole new reality called the New Jerusalem. And Revelation 7, verse 9 says that there is going to be a day when every tongue, tribe, and nation will gather as those who are followers in Christ. And in Revelation 21, you begin to see this clarity of what this new heaven and new earth will be. And let me just read it for you. It says this, John, the gospel writer, writes this, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people. And God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away.'" Friends, this is where the story goes. And the beauty is, Jesus is calling out of our familiar to bear witness to the people that we think are less than, to the people we can't stand, to the people we have no desire to understand, for the new Jerusalem will be our eternal homeland. And I start really wrestling with this. I start really thinking about this. I'm up in a holding pattern above O'Hare, and I'm really reflecting on this, and I begin to recognize, oh my goodness, if this is going to be every tongue, tribe, and nation, if heaven is going to be like the ultimate bias cleanse, where we literally see people as God sees them, centered around the Son, Jesus, then this earth right now is preparation for eternity. I know a lot of people, sincere people, who have a lot of people in their life that they see as less than, that they can't stand, and have no desire to understand, which just makes me wonder how much they're going to enjoy their eternal homeland. And maybe what Jesus wants to do is teach us and prepare us for what the rest of our life will be when we are with him in heaven. Does this make sense? Now, let me take this even farther. Heartland, you know how I first heard about you? I first heard about this church a number of years ago. I wasn't even living in Illinois at the time. But I heard about Heartland as being one of the first churches in the country to go serve down with Hurricane Katrina. Oh, just think about this for a second. Because you all actually were like, hey, there is actual tragedy. And I watched and heard of a lot of churches were like, we'll just sing a song or pray for them. You literally rallied people, rallied resources, and you literally went down there and served and loved, and other churches followed your example, your lead. And what happened? The Spirit came upon this place in power, and you were bearing witness to what Jesus is all about. But let me ask you this. Can you imagine if you didn't go? Man, what would that look like? What would that mean? And I think about my own life. What happens when I choose just to stay put in Jerusalem and I don't allow the Spirit's power to help me really break through these places where there's broken parts in me of people I view as less than, people I can't stand, or issues I have no desire to understand? What if God wants to use you and me to really showcase who he is, to help someone discover the grace, truth, and peace that's found in Christ alone? But if we only stay in J-Town in Jerusalem, we'll miss it. We'll miss it. Let me take this even farther. How do we do this? How do we actually allow ourselves to be the kind of people who have the Spirit's power and alive and at work in us? There's three words. Three words that I hope that you will hold on to. Three words I hope that you will discuss this week when you sit around the table or in living rooms with people who are in your life. Three words that I hope maybe you'll even engage your kids and students with. Because I believe that these three words will demonstrate the Spirit's power is alive in you. The first one is this. The first word is aware. Aware. Every one of us has to be aware of our familiar. Every one of us has to be aware of the places and the people at which we view ourselves as superior. Every one of us has to be aware of the places at which we need to seek God's guidance and wisdom and strength to have a bias cleanse so we can see people as God sees people. Here's a couple of ideas when I think about this word aware. Questions I often reflect with. I got to be aware of what's my familiar. What have I been taught about how the world works? What have I been taught on how to see people? And how is that different than what the scriptures teaches me or how Jesus truly lived? And then I'm going to ask, who is less than in my life? Who is less than in my life besides Ohio State fans, because that's okay. But who is less than? Or who are people you can't stand? Who are people in your life that you're, I can't stand that coworker. I can't stand that person. I can't stand that family member. I can't stand that group of people, I can't stand them. And maybe you just need to be honest before God and say, that is in me. Give me a cleansing so that I can see people like you see people. Or what do you have, like, no desire to understand? You hear it on the news and you're like, oh my goodness, this is happening, and I wish I could just ignore that I heard that. Trafficking that's happening. Abuse of power that's happening. Racism that's happening. Stuff that's happening and around the globe that's happening. And maybe God's just starting to stir, saying, you know what? I've given you spiritual gifts. I've given you a mind. I've given you some influence. I actually want to use you, but you got to be open. And then I have to remember, where is my eternal homeland? That's heaven. And what's heaven going to be like? Heaven ought to be our vision for how we want to live today. Even Jesus, in his epic prayer, says, man, I pray that your will be done here on earth like it's done in heaven. And the whole idea is that we should bring heaven here to Rockford, here into every conversation that we have. So number one, aware. But let's go back. Number two, second word. I think it's just mission critical. If we're going to demonstrate that the Spirit's power is alive in us, we have to be willing to invest. Invest. And this is where we are literally kind of going into conversations, sharing, learning, getting to know our friends in Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. When I was a pastor in Grand Rapids, a group of us used to meet, some pastors. And there's a few, you know, Caucasian pastors and a few pastors that were persons of color. And we were sitting at this diner. I love diners. Fatty, good food. And I'm just like eating. And one of my buddies, this white pastor in Grand Rapids, begins to share what happened to him at Thanksgiving. He'd gone home to Ohio, seated around the table. And every family's got a cousin Eddie, right? Every family's got someone who's just a little bit off. And as they're seated around this table, his daughter, who's in seventh grade, is there. And this cousin Eddie just begins to mouth off with such racism. Like, words that were toxic and sick and go against the image of God that these other friends have. And my friend's telling the story, and he says, you know, my seventh grade daughter is looking at me like, make it stop, Dad, make it stop, Dad. My seventh grade daughter even kicked me underneath the table. And I literally just kind of held her arm, just nodded in my head, and just wished that the conversation would end. And then he asked this black pastor from the city of Grand Rapids. He said, how should I have handled that? I'll never forget this moment. When I looked up at this pastor, he started to cry. And you know what he said? I thought we were friends. And my buddy was like, oh, we're friends. He goes, no, I thought we were friends. And I know we're friends. I don't know if you understand what friendship means. See, friendship for me, this black pastor says, is that I actually take you into every conversation. And when some people like to make statements about white people, I go, oh, I know a couple. And they're actually pretty awesome. And I stop people. And what's amazing to me is your daughter understood this. She's more of a friend than we are. And secondly, I question how well you know the gospel, because you literally don't think cousin Eddie will ever change. So how strong is the grace and the peace and the truth that Jesus demonstrated on the cross? And I was sitting there like literally mind blown. And then this black pastor says, here's what I would invite you to do. I would invite you to go talk to your seventh grade daughter and look her in the eye and tell her you're sorry and actually tell her, I'll never let that happen again on my watch. I will care for my friends. That's what investment is. It's not just knowing the name. It's knowing the stories and holding those friendships. Can you imagine if we had those with people we once were like, I'm less than, or once, can't stand, once, no desire to understand? man, the Spirit's power would be alive in us. Third word, aware, invest. Third word, sustain. And this is important because your investment and your awareness is working towards sustainable flourishing. Real quick, any of you know a pastor by the name of Harvey Carey? Show of hands. Okay, you should. Harvey Carey was a pastor in the south side of Chicago at Salem Baptist. He was a youth pastor, and he would run prayer trainings. And you know what he would do? He wouldn't have you show up to, like, just the church and go into some building, some room in the basement. Harvey would say, okay, show up to church, and then you're going to get into these vans. And people are like, I thought this was a prayer class. He goes, oh, it is. And where he would take them is to a crack house on the south side of Chicago. And he would surround them around this crack house and say, I'm going to teach you how to pray. And we're going to pray that light and peace and grace and truth and justice would show up in this house. So let's start praying. And people are like, can we go back to the basement? And Harvey Carey, he's like drinking from a fire hydrant. It's passion and sweat and gospel, and you are just moved. I love this man. He's been a mentor to me. And so when I was in the northwest suburbs of Chicago, I called him one day and said, hey, man, I'm aware of kind of my Judea, Samaria, my ends of the earth. I'm recognizing there's so much going on in the city of Chicago. I don't know what to do. But, man, I wonder, we've invested, we know each other. What sustainable flourishing would look like? And I started thinking, man, what would it look like if, like, we could really create this model with students? And he goes, man, I love that idea. He's like, you know what would be really helpful is if you actually take a whole bunch of high school students and bring them down to the south side, take them from like the northwest suburbs, bring them down to the south side and teach them how to like fill out college applications. Give them a vision for like what they could do and what schools they could go to. That'd be a real gift. And I was like, oh, that's easy. We could do that. And he goes, and I think we could teach your kids something. And I was like, do tell. He goes, I think we could teach your kids how to survive. I think some of your kids in the northwest suburbs are a little weak. I'm like, okay. And he goes, think about it. Our kids, CPS closes schools, and they got to pass through multiple gangs just to get on a bus to go to school. Your kids don't have to deal with that. They face adversity day in and day out, and they have found an opportunity to continue to go. And I just go, you teach us, we teach you. Can you imagine what the church would look like? And friends, I'm telling you, this is what sustainable flourishing looks like. It's not just me coming, but it's we building what Christ wants to see together. But let me take it even farther. As I started really reflecting on this, this one question haunted me. Have you ever thought about this? What's God's bias to you? Like, what's God's literal bias to you? And I'm sitting up there on this plane, I got my journal out. I just really start to think about this. I know what I've done. I know who I am. I know I am a broken man. I know my sin patterns. I know the things that are in my life. And you know what? God's bias towards me and God's bias towards you has always, ever, only been love. A reckless love that went after you. A reckless love that chased you down. A love that was so great that he was willing to go to the cross for you. And the gift isn't that we just receive that and stay put in the familiar. You know what it is? You know what? It's just mind-blowing. As Jesus said, that the Spirit's power is going to come upon you. And if you let it, he's actually going to let you carry his story and bear witness to what he did in you, how he rescued you, how he saved you, and you're actually going to get the invitation and the chance to go to Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth. But here's the thing, today more than ever, people are staying put, which makes me question. Do they have the Spirit's power? Can you imagine if every one of us was so close to how God rescued us and so longing to receive that Spirit's power that will say, where you want to go, I'll go. Give me a bias cleanse. Because I'll tell you what, Martin's dream was God's hope. Martin's dream was God's plan. Martin's dream was God's plan and Jesus' vision. And every one of us can get on that plane, can get on that path. But you got to be willing to receive the Spirit's power.